Our first presentation of the evening focuses on deep learning reconstruction, given by Dr. Ewoud Smit of the Radboud University Medical Center in Nijmegen, Netherlands. With a master's in physics from the University of Groningen and an MD-PhD from the University of Utrecht, Dr. Smit enjoys both mathematical and the medical components of deep learning applications. He has multiple publications in radiology, and tonight will concentrate on deep learning and CT oncology. Please welcome Dr. Smit.
Thank you, Shelton. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a real honor for me to present here tonight at the Kennedy Medical Customer Event. This RSNA, you will see a lot about deep learning and artificial intelligence. If you will walk through the exhibition hall, you will see many companies that promote their artificial intelligence products, ranging from cancer detection to organ segmentation to workflow improvements. If you go to scientific sessions, you will see many research groups showing their results of their artificial intelligence and deep learning research. These are very exciting times. But tonight, I would like to discuss the first major clinical application of deep learning in clinical practice, which is deep learning reconstruction, a new technique for CT image reconstruction. We have used this technique over the last 6 months in our clinic, and I'd like to share our clinical experiences with you. I'm very fortunate to work as a radiologist in Nijmegen. We are here in Chicago, and here's Japan, and Nijmegen is here in the Netherlands. We are one of the largest research centers in Europe, and have a strong focus on artificial intelligence and on deep learning. We have a close collaboration with Canon, and we are one of the first to evaluate new products. And as a result, we have deep learning reconstruction available on both our Genesis and Precision scanners. And one of the best things about working in Nijmegen is that we have a great team where we closely collaborate with radiologists, radiographers, and physicists. Well, to be honest, I've always been a bit disappointed in iterative reconstruction. Iterative reconstruction images, they may look artificial and plastic, especially at low dose. And we see a lot of images like these from referring hospitals, and we find it difficult to read them. As radiologists, we feel less confident with artificial-looking images, because when they're artifacts, can we still trust the image? Well, here, for example, in the bowel wall. Is this bowel wall thickening? Are those tumor deposits? Or is it just normal? Well, you may probably remember that when iterative reconstruction was first introduced, it was difficult to convince radiologists. Adoption was slow. And when I gave presentations about dose reduction, I always asked who has iterative reconstruction available and who uses it. And then half of the hands went down. You may probably remember this from your own clinic. And if dose was not a risk issue, many radiologists would probably still use filtered back projection. Well, image quality has strongly improved with model-based iterative reconstruction methods, such as FIRST. But these methods are very computational intensive, and reconstruction times are long. Often it takes even longer for the scans to reconstruct than to put the next patient on the table. And therefore, a reconstruction queue exists, requiring reconstructions overnight. And therefore, we will make limited use of these techniques in clinical practice. And we only use them for specific indications. Well, the real challenge of image reconstruction is computing power. Sir Hounsfield already proposed to use iterative reconstruction techniques, but for years we have used filtered back projection simply because it was much faster. So they probably use mediocre machines, you may ask yourself. What if we had a supercomputer? Well, where do you think the Canon reconstruction server should be located on this line? Well, it appears that they already use supercomputers for image reconstruction, close to the computing power of IBM's Watson. So, what do we want? We want images with excellent image quality. which means that these images should have sharp edges, they should have low noise, and they should appear natural. And they should be available quickly. And we want to use them in all patients. And all of this at low dose, preferably. And is further dose reduction a priority? Yes, I do think so. Not only for young people and in pediatrics, but especially also in oncology. Because with new therapies, such as immunotherapy, survival of oncology patients has increased. And these patients, they require follow-up, of course. On the right is an example of a patient who underwent over 20 CT scans over the last years. And this becomes more common. And therefore, dose reduction is very important. Because we want to give these patients confidence about their disease, but we want to give them new tumors from the radiation exposure. Well, with model-based iterative reconstruction, it is possible to make very nice images by doing advanced modeling. But this requires too much time for daily clinical routine. And this is where deep learning comes to place. So, what is deep learning? Artificial intelligence? I found this very confusing when I first heard about all these techniques. Well, artificial intelligence can be defined as that a computer performs a task that is normally requiring human intelligence. So, this is artificial intelligence, and deep learning is then a type of artificial intelligence where the computer learns the task by itself. And deep learning is a method, then again, to perform artificial intelligence and machine learning. And this deep learning is now very popular because the computing powers, the computers are now powerful enough to perform these tasks. So, with deep learning, the computer can learn what a high-quality image should look like by training a neural network. And the target images are obtained by advanced model-based iterative reconstruction. And these images have been processed for hours to days. And then the neural network, which has been trained, is used to reconstruct new images from the scanner with high image quality. And the real advantage of deep learning this approach is that the model that is trained offline, and that's time consuming. But applying this model in clinical practice is really fast. But isn't this dangerous? Could the computer, for example, introduce new artifacts that may look like a tumor? Or could it suppress metastasis? Well, we have, of course, also asked this ourselves. But we didn't see any of these artifacts over the last half year. And this is because Canon has developed a very, very clever method. Because instead of directly learning the high-quality images from the input data, the system is trained on many low-dose scans. And the system can therefore learn how to reduce noise and to enhance signal, instead of learning anatomy and pathology. And it's therefore also a very powerful method for dose reduction. And Canon refers to this technique as AiCE. I'd like to show you an example. This is a scan that has been reconstructed with filtered back projection. And now with Ada 3D. And this is with FIRST, and then the images become somewhat artificial. But then with AiCE, it becomes natural again. And if you now compare Ada 3D to AiCE, we see that noise is strongly reduced. And if we use filtered back projection and compare it to AiCE, then the difference is clear. So, what do these images look like in clinical practice? I'd like to show you some clinical examples. Here's an example of a patient with peritoneal metastasis. And here we see some free fluid on the Ada 3D images on the left with normal resolution. And on the right with AiCE, with a high resolution scan, we see that there's less noise in the free fluid and that the bowel wall is better demarcated. And if we zoom in, we see here again free fluid. And here's a tumor deposit. They have about the same density, and it's difficult to distinguish the bowel wall. But if we look here at the AiCE images, we see the free fluid and the tumor, which is better demarcated. Here's a pancreatic scan at 0.25 millimeters, reconstructed with Ada 3D. And if we then apply AiCE, we see a hypovascular lesion in the pancreatic body, which is suspicious for a pancreatic tumor. And I particularly like how well the bowel walls are visible with the new technique. For example, here in the pelvis, which is traditionally a region where there are a lot of artifacts, as you may know. And also here on the coronal images, you can nicely appreciate the bowel wall and see that there's no bowel wall thickening. And while these images may look nice, the real 3D data sets look even better. It is difficult to appreciate only from a projector. So I'd like to invite you to have a look for yourself at the booth and scroll through the images. And then you can appreciate the noise and the sharpness of the images. So where in the early days we had difficulty convincing people of the new reconstruction techniques, now even the most conservative radiologists in our department come to me and they say, "Hey Ewoud, these images look very nice and they give me more diagnostic confidence. We did not have any problems with adaptation. And now we use AiCE as our standard reconstruction technique." So how fast is it? Well, the exact reconstruction times, they depend on your system, but it's similar to Ada 3D in clinical practice, which means that we now use AiCE for all our indications, and our radiographers are really happy. And how much does it reduce the dose? Well, here's an overview of the dose reports of a high-resolution precision scanner for standard chest CT abdomen scans. On the left is in the months before AiCE, and on the right, the months after AiCE. And we see that the dose in real clinical practice has been reduced with about 60%. And the great thing is that AiCE is also included in the automatic exposure control, which makes dose reduction easy, so there's no trial and error. And for the Genesis, the dose reduction is about 20%. Here's an example of an ultra-high resolution scan of a patient with severe emphysema and lung fibrosis at 0.25 millimeter sections and a dose of 0.5 millisievert. And here's an example of a low-dose chest CT of a patient with a cavitating pneumonia at a dose of 0.1 millisievert. And it's about the same dose as an AP and lateral chest X-ray. And still, the image quality of the soft tissue is very nice. Well, we all agree that dose reduction is important, but should it lead to more imaging? Yes, I do believe so when it leads to better survival of our patients. But how do we handle all these extra scans? We're already so busy. Do we need more radiologists? So this is something where artificial intelligence will be very helpful. Computers may screen for normal images, and they may point us at abnormalities, or help us with grades or classifications. And we will see many of these future applications at this RSNA. But today, we learned about the first application of deep learning in daily clinical practice, which provides us excellent image quality, fast reconstruction times, and substantial dose reduction. So we have tomorrow's radiology available today. Thank you for your attention.